Okay, we are with Rheem Heavy Duty, or otherwise known as the GNU Ultra Low Nox Workhorse Water Heater for Rheem Manufacturing. This water heater is your basic commercial water heater that you will find in high output restaurants, more than 6-unit apartment units, or in just something like a hotel that actually needs a large volume of hot water and a higher recovery rate than your average light duty commercial water heater. This water heater has multiple water ports. It has two in the front, two on the top, and two in the back. It comes equipped with water heater dip tube, or water dip tube, that goes down into the bottom of the water heater, that shoots water into the bottom of the water heater, so it heats from the bottom up instead of from the top down. Rheem supplies a diffuser tube if you are going to use the side water ports to fill the water heater with water. There's a mark on the bottom of the diffuser tube that tells you where that mark should be. It should be pointing down in the water heater, so the water actually flows down into the bottom of the water heater. It's a very important element to actually satisfy the thermostats. So now you know that your diffuser tube is actually going to shoot water in down in the bottom of the water heater. There are instructions with the diffuser tube that comes with it. It is equipped with each one of the water heaters. This particular water heater that we are dealing with is a 72-gallon, 250,000 BTU heater. It needs combustion air equivalent to those BTUs. And the rule of thumb that is printed in the Houston Care Manual is that it is 1 square inch per 1,000 BTUs. So you will need 270 square inches of combustion air. Very important that you have that combustion air to feed into the air plenum at the bottom of the water heater, which we'll get back to in a minute. Gas pressure. It's also very crucial for this unit. This unit needs a minimum of 4.5 water columns up to, I believe it's 10.5 max. So it needs to be in between that to actually fire and operate this water heater efficiently and correctly, so there's no problems with the operation of it. The last part of it is, as we always talk about, is exhaust. This is a 6-inch fitting. It's an adjustable fitting that you can actually make a 90-degree elbow, or you can make a 45-degree elbow out of it, but it's only 6 inches. That needs to rise another 6 inches. Now that is a full foot, straight up. Before you take it and put a 90-degree elbow or a 45-degree elbow, it must rise 1 foot out of the top of the water heater. Why? Because when this water heater fires, it has a great burst of energy that bursts up through the burner chamber and pushes out to the exhaust. If there's any restrictions, it's going to push back into the burner chamber and cause ignition problems and other problems with your burner chamber, premature burnout of your burners, and so forth. The elbow can be a 45 or even a 90-degree elbow. If it is a 90-degree elbow, you must make that 90-degree elbow rise whatever horizontal run you're running 1 inch per foot. Okay? Very important that this flows as freely as possible, because what's going to happen, that the air coming off the air plenum is going to blow a burst of energy when the burner fires, and it needs to burst up and rise and go out of the building. If you do not do that, you will experience what we call a blowback here and back into the chamber, and it will cause damage to your ignition system and your burners. Okay, getting back to the combustion air, this is your air plenum and your blower motor. The blower motor is equipped with its own filter system, but it needs to be kept clean. This is an outside filter. There is an inside filter, which we will show you real quick. There's your inside filter or blower screen. Needs to be kept clean. On every water heater, the water heater has a sticker that says blower screen may need periodic cleaning. You can actually take this blower screen off. You can take it and wash it with the water hose, put it in your sink and wash it, dry it off and put it back in. But you must also clean this screen as well. And it's just as simple as getting a damp rag and wiping it clean. Very important. That is the basic maintenance that this water heater requires. As with most commercial water heaters, this water heater is technically self-diagnosing. It has what we call a light sentinel on the control box. Each light indicates a certain level of where the water heater is operating and ultimately firing. So every light tells you where that system is at before the water heater fires. If it stops at, we'll say, thermostat, there's something obviously wrong with the thermostat. If it stops at the ignition, there's something obviously wrong with your igniter. If it stops at pilot valve, there's something obviously wrong with the gas valve slash pilot valve. And if it stops at ECO, which is your safety device, otherwise known as a pressure switch, it's right underneath the unit right here with the clear tube going out, there's something going on with the pressure switch. And lastly, the main valve, if it doesn't light up, there's more than likely something going on with the main valve. This water heater has a 24 volt system that runs 24 volts throughout each one of the components. The components are actually operated by that 24 volts. So whenever a light lights up, that 24 volts has now went to that component and sent it to the next component and so forth throughout the system. The blue wire running through the whole system is your 24 volt checking point. So you could take your multimeter and you can take the plug off here, and it has a little connector. You could take your multimeter and actually plug it into the connector. They are ironically exactly the same size as your multimeter points. And all you do is just put it in there and find somewhere to ground the negative lead on your multimeter and you test for 24 volts. There's no need to go into that, but if you are needing to test, that's how you do. And you will find that blue wire running throughout the system. Wherever you look through this whole system, you're gonna find a blue wire. So you can test the 24 volts at each one of those points, okay? As we spoke about earlier about the combustion air, your air plenum houses your igniter, your burner, and your burner orifices that are very crucial to the water heater burning and burning efficiently. I am going to turn this water heater on, and obviously we're not using any gas today, so it's going to go all the way through the system, all the way down to the main valve. Obviously it's not going to go past and ignite the main valve because there is no gas. Remember, each light indicates a certain part of the 24 volt system of when it's working and when it's not working. And we'll show you some tips on how to do that. First, we're going to start at the top. The very top of this thing is what we call a damper. The damper is an energy efficient product. It has a rotating cover that actually closes down as the water heater shuts down, or as the water heater fires, it opens up. This device must open up completely before this water heater will fire. If it doesn't open up completely, the water heater will not fire, and you will not get anything past the thermostat light because the thermostat is actually calling for heat. So I'm going to put this back on for a second, and we're going to show you how that works. It has a Molex connector that plugs into the damper. It only goes in one way, so you can't mess it up. There are four wires into it, a red, yellow, white, and of course blue for the 24 volts. That 24 volts is coming from down inside of your control box. It's where it starts. I have a little pigtail connected to the water heater. It's got 110 voltage, and then it goes into a transformer, and out of the transformer into a fuse block, and then a fuse block through the module, the ignition module, back from the module, back up to the thermostat, back up to your damper, and then it comes back down, goes to your ECL, which is your pressure switch, and down finally to your gas valve. The same blue wire controls every one of these components. Remember that. Blue wire is very important. We're going to put our cover back on. And there is a control or a power button on the side of the box. So you don't have to continue unplug and plug it in. Each unit is supplied with an on-off switch. When we turn this unit on, the first thing we're going to see is a green light. The next light we should see, or at the same time as we turn it on, the thermostat was lighting on because there's no water installed in this water heater and the thermostat is actually turned all the way off. So whatever the temperature is inside of this tank, it is going to tell us that it needs to fire. So I'm going to put the thermostat cover back on. And we're going to turn the guy on. And immediately we have three lights. Why do we have three lights? Because the damper was already in the open position. I'm going to pull the damper plug. And it shuts off. And you have two lights. Why do you have two lights? You have a power button. Obviously, you have power on it. You have a thermostat. The water heater is saying the water is too cold. We need to fire it up. The only problem is that because the damper is unplugged, it won't go past the damper. I can take the damper itself and just turn it slightly. Oh. Where it's not actually straight up and down. We'll put it back on top of the water heater, or better yet, maybe we can show you like this. And I can plug it in, and you can watch that damper rotating. See it rotating? It's going to rotate all the way around to the open position. And once it gets to the open position, it's going to activate the next light on the light sentinel. The next light would be ignition. The next light would be pilot valve and ECL. So it's already checked the other two components, which we'll get to in a second, and I'll show you exactly how that works. The damper arm rotates freely because if it doesn't rotate all the way around freely, it will get jammed up and it will not fire the water heater. The damper comes with a feature that right now is only exclusive to Rheem. It has what we call a bypass feature on it. It's kind of hard to see, but there's a button on the backside of the damper that allows you to put it into hold open or automatic operation. Automatic operation means that it will rotate around and open up and close. If you put it into the hold open position, which I'm going to do now, no matter what, this damper will not open, but it will continue to fire the unit. And from that point on, once it opens all the way up, for now on, all I got to do is turn the switch on and the damper will not open anymore. So why is this important? Because sometimes these dampers have a problem. To keep the water heater going, all you have to do is put it into that bypass mode and you'll be good. Okay, so it's open again. Now when I turn the switch off this time, it will automatically go, it's automatically in the bypass mode and it will just start from there. So no matter what I do, unless I unplug that, the water heater will never open that damper up again until you replace the motor or you decide you don't have to need it. You don't need it at all. Okay. Moving on down to the thermostat. The thermostat is right below the damper and it's always sitting there, and sometimes it's loose or even the wires are loose and you want to check those connections and make sure they're all tight. But I'm going to turn the water heater on again and I'm going to show you what happens when you mess with the blue wire or disconnect the blue wire in the 24-volt system on the thermostat. Okay? We're going to let it go right through the operating procedure. The damper is now out of play, so we're good. I'm going to pull the blue wire, and you're going to see the water heater shut down all the way back to the power light. Why is it back at the power light? Because the next light is a thermostat. There's no 24 volts at the thermostat, meaning that the thermostat is not in play. We're going to take it and we're going to plug it back in, and immediately the water heater goes back to normal operation mode. So remember that 24 volts again comes into play. Thermostat has to be plugged in with the 24 volts. Okay? Because the damper is now out of play, we're now at the thermostat, and now the next thing is that it sends it from the thermostat down to ignition. Ignition is actually the igniter, which we'll get to in a little while, and then it goes down to the pilot valve and the ECO, which are also controlled by the 24 volts. The only component that is not controlled by the 24 volts after it leaves the thermostat is actually the igniter. The igniter has one wire on it, and it's an orange wire, and we'll get to that in a little bit, okay? So I'm gonna turn it back off again. I'm gonna put the cover back on the thermostat because we don't need to go any farther. We know the thermostat is working. We're gonna pull the cover back off of the control panel. And if you look, there's your blue wire again. It's in the fuse block. Then it's down here on your control module, which this is your control valve. It's a Honeywell control module that has been installed in commercial water heaters for, I don't know, maybe 20 years now, or maybe even longer. But they're very important. And if you look again, you'll see that same blue wire on your ECO or slash pressure switch. Okay? Follow that same thing down to the gas valve. Guess what's down there? Our blue wire. So each one of these components, I can show you what happens when you disconnect the blue wire. So we're going to turn it back on again. Next component will be ignition, right? So we turn it back on. There's our lights, all of our lights. But what happens when we pull the blue wire on the module? Nothing. Why? Because the 24 volts is not operating the rest of the system. However, because the blue wire is not connected, now your ECO is not protecting the water heater anymore, because that's where that blue wire flows. It goes right from here down to your pressure switch. Very important that this blue wire is connected. You put it back in, and we take the same blue wire and we pull it off of your ECO. Nothing happened. But if we go back and pull it off of there, we have no protection from your module and no protection for your ECO. Water heater would fire and you would have a dangerous time bomb because it's not working. The other components on the other side are your 24 volts that run through what wire? The red wire along with the module. So if I go and I pull the red wire on the module and then again on the ECO, you have no protection from your ECO, even though you disconnected the 24 volts. So let's plug her back in. Okay, so we know that the ECO is working because everything is there as far as the lights are concerned. What we don't have anything going on at the gas valve because we don't have any gas. If I take the one other wire that is remaining on the ECO, which is the yellow wire, and pull it off the ECO along with the red and the blue, what happened to the lights? We're back at ignition because we don't have any 24 volts running through the ECO. Put it back. Red, blue, and as soon as I do, all the lights come right back on. So now you're protected. Your pressure switch is actually protected. However, if I come over, see the clear plastic tube running to your ECO? If I pull it off of the air plenum, you immediately lose your ECO and your pilot valve. Just to show you what happens, watch what happens when I blow into the ECO. Take the air off of it. It no longer wants to protect the water heater, so you have no protection for your safety device. Put it back on there again, and lights should come back on again. The ECO device is very crucial to being this water heater operating safely. So it needs to be very, very clean and protected, okay? Particles can actually end up in the plastic tube and actually go into your ECO device and clog it up. If this water heater is installed in a commercial garage or in a washroom in a apartment building or even in a restaurant where it's high use, you don't want this filter or this blower screen to get clogged up with anything. You want to keep it as clean as possible. And then, as I said earlier, there's an inner screen. So I'm going to show you what happens when I turn the water heater on and it's pulling in fresh, clean air and everything is operating normally, except for our gas, of course. What happens when you clog it? It's a single ply toilet paper sheet. Watch what happens when I put this on the blower and actually watch the lights on the Sentinel box. What happens? Automatically went back to ignition. Pull it off, and it should fire the lights right back up. Again, single ply, or in this case, maybe some lint from a dryer, will just clog it up. Now, keeping in mind, that is the inner screen. This is the outer screen. So obviously, it won't happen unless you block the whole screen off. I don't think I could do it with my hands. I could try. No. So that is the reason why we put the outer screen on there, to protect the inner screen. But when cleaning the inner screen, you need to clean the outer screen as well. They both need to be cleaned at the same time. One more important element. I talked about earlier that the igniter is the orange wire that runs into the module where it says spark. If there is no spark, there's no firing this water heater. So we're going to take this off and we're going to see what happens without it on. It's at ignition. Even though all the lights lit up, without the spark, the water heater is not going to fire, obviously. So how do you test that? You want to make sure that the module is putting off a spark. So all you do is hold this close, and there's your spark. So now you know you have a sparking igniter, even though it's still in the unit. We're going to show you what happens when you take the igniter out, what will happen. So all you know is that it's not sparking. So if I put this on, we know it's sparking inside of the unit. At least it's sparking at that point. So the only thing that needs to happen now is that gas needs to open up in the gas valve and fire the unit up. Doesn't do that, it's not going to fire the unit. Okay. Opened up the air plenum box. I'm going to show you where the igniter is, where it's located, and how to remove it, and how to test it to see if it's actually working, and more importantly, how to clean it. So this air plenum has 9 screws, and I've already pre-removed 7 of them. We're going to remove, 6 of them. We're going to remove the final 3 and take the air plenum off. And take the air plenum down. And if you look inside, you will see a burner. You will also see the igniter wire, which is the orange wire. And you will see your pilot tube going up into the unit. This right here is your burner tube that actually sends the gas into the unit, and your orifices are right there on each one of the witch column. There are actually 3 burners at the bottom. You can see them inside of the unit. The igniter goes up into the unit that's actually up against the firewall of the burner chamber, sitting above the burner tubes, okay? We are going to remove the pilot, and we're gonna unscrew the first screw on the right side, and then we're gonna unscrew the screw on the left side. Okay, the igniter will not pull straight out of the unit. You have to turn it. You have to turn it either up or down to allow the butterfly of the igniter to actually come through the burner tube hole. We have a little problem with our wire here, so we go back, take our wire off, and unwrap it from the pilot tube so we have enough room to pull it out. And there is your GNU igniter. It is one of the most rigid igniters on the market. It very rarely fails. If it does, it's because the unit is not burning properly, either from your combustion air, your gas flow, or your exhaust air. And a lot of times when that's happening, the flames will roll out inside of the chamber and actually burn up your igniter. Just like your barbecue igniter on your barbecue that sits there and gets burned and burned and burned, eventually it continually burns out. This rod is called your spark ignition because it has the orange wire that goes up into the module, but it's also acting as the flame sensor that actually senses the correct flame to rectify, to actually fire your burner. If it's not sensing the right witch column, it's not rectifying, it will not fire the burner. You notice that there's a butterfly pilot. There's 2 sections to it. The flame rod is actually sitting to the left side, or if you're reversed, to the right side of the butterfly. Don't think it really matters which one it's in, but most of the time to the left. You'll also notice that there is a sight window that lines up when it's inside of the unit like this with the sight glass from the front of your air plenum. So when you're looking through, you're actually looking through both of the sight glasses, and you can actually see the flame or the pilot actually burning inside of the unit. Very important element. So when you're putting your igniter back in, the sight glass goes to the right of the unit that matches the sight glass on your air plenum sight glass. Very important. If it's reversed, you're not going to rectify and you are not going to actually fire the unit. Now, we're going to do a little test that I don't recommend to your average plumber doing or your average technician. This is usually for HVAC guys or people that understand hot water heating and understand how it works. We're going to plug the igniter back into the module, and we're going to turn the unit on, and you're actually going to be able to see the igniter sparking and trying to light the pilot after it goes through the regular system that it regularly goes through. And if it doesn't, there's a little trick that shows you how. But there you go. It's trying to light the pilot right now. That little spark ignition is enough to light the pilot on the left side, as I said, of the butterfly of the pilot. it lights the pilot. The next thing will happen is the main valve will open up and your water heater fires. If that is not sparking down there, it is not going to fire the water heater because you have nothing to actually start the process to start the burner to actually burn. Once you've got that, you know that you have spark ignition. You have everything from the 24 volts from the damper, well, from the thermostat to the damper, back through the module, back down to everything but the pilot valve, or the pilot is actually burning, but the gas valve has not opened up yet. There is one very important element that usually comes into play. The gas valve, unlike any other water heater, actually has a control that you can actually turn it on and turn it off. Remember that the gas valve, just like all the other components, has the 24 volt system on it too with the blue wire. However, it's the only component that has two other wires on it that have to do with the 24 volt that needs to operate the system. So once it goes down to the gas valve and the 24 volts down on the blue wire, there's also a white wire, and there's also a brown wire. Now, the significance of that is that if you look on the module, you will find the blue wire, the white wire, and the brown wire in that order. The same on the gas valve, except for it's left to right on the module, and then it's from bottom to top on the gas valve. And each one of those things are the MV, which is the main valve, your 24 volts on the gas valve, your MVPV on the white wire, which operates both the pilot valve and the gas valve itself. And then the third one is the brown wire on the pilot valve. You cannot get gas to the pilot without that brown wire being connected. That's what shoots the gas from the gas valve into the pilot section of the gas valve and fires the pilot. On the gas valve, I have a second gas valve in my hand, you will see that it is marked MV, MVPV, and PV. Blue, white, brown is the color sequence on the gas valve from bottom to top, or brown, white, blue from top to bottom. Okay, so what we're gonna do now is I'm gonna tell you about the common failures or problems with this water heater. There are three of them, okay? One very important is the damper at the top. We talked about how to bypass or put the damper into bypass mode. If you cannot get the damper into bypass mode for any reason with the switch, you can pull the plug and you can run a jumper between the red and the blue wires. What that means is take a piece of metal wiring and stick it in the prongs only on the red and the blue. Very important that it's on the red and the blue, because if you jump either one of those other wires, and particularly the yellow wire, now you're jumping the thermostat. You don't want to jump the thermostat because that means the light will not come on, the thermostat will not ever close, and will not ever shut the water heater off. So remember, if you have to jump it, it is only on the blue and the red wires only, on the damper, okay? We put the damper back together. Remember the blue wire on the thermostat, you have no problems there unless and you don't get anything when you turn the heater on. Automatically you should know, because you only got a power light, there's nothing on, there's one or two things wrong. The thermostat is satisfied, or that blue wire is disconnected. And if the thermostat is satisfied, all you have to do is turn the thermostat up to another temperature until it clicks and it will fire the water heater. If it doesn't, then that blue wire somewhere is disconnected. We put it back on and it fires it up. Second to lastly, the ECO / pressure switch. As we talked about earlier, with the filters or the blower screens being dirty, doesn't satisfy the pressure switch or the ECO, it no longer will fire the water heater. Common, replace the pressure switch, okay? And lastly, the igniter itself, as we talked about, very important that the flame rod is sitting on the left side of the butterfly of the pilot, and it's usually about an eighth of an inch away from the center of that butterfly. And then the last very important thing is, if this is what, how I do, I take my finger and I measure the length of the pilot. Why do I do that? Because now I take my finger and I can stick it inside of the burner chamber. And I stick it inside the burner chamber. What I want to know, is there anything in there that is actually touching the pilot? From the length of the finger of the pilot, so this one's actually to like the very bottom of my knuckle. So when I stick my finger in there, I want to make sure when I stick the pilot in there, nothing is actually touching the pilot. Because if something inside the chamber is touching the pilot, it will short out the pilot or ground it out and it will not fire. Very important. Okay, so if the water heater is year old, 2 years old, 3 years old, it is very important that there's nothing obstructing that pilot when you replace it or put it back in after cleaning, because it could have been the problem in the first place. Other than that, the water heater is a very self-sufficient operating unit as long as the screens are kept clean, and after a period of time, you actually flush it. Each commercial water heater is actually equipped with a clean-out cover. And when you get the heater, well, there's usually a replacement gasket that is behind here. There's actually a thing where you can actually open up the side of the water heater and actually pull sediment out, clean it, put a new seal back on it, and seal it back up. Every water heater is pressure tested at the factory, as far as the tank and temperature and pressure relief valve. Local codes say you must hook the pressure relief valve to an outside water source. Other than that, that is our GNU, my friends.